take a look at that. Okay, so the concept that we have here, we have these coordinate functions on the interval mapping to Rn. We can require these to be continuous and differentiable, and so we can certainly do calculus on these functions of a real variable. If we're careful about how we manage this, we will be able to construct a calculus on points of a topological manifold. So let's be specific here. What we're going to do here is to calculate the explicit form of the differential along the curve as a function of the parameter. So we have a parameterized curve in E2 here in Euclidean space and xy coordinates, and so we have the coordinate functions gamma 1 and gamma 2 that give you the x and y, and then the differentials dx and dy from differentiating these two equations up here. By the way, if you'd like to see what the curve gamma looks like in the local tangent space where dx and dy are the coordinates of points, you can solve this equation right here and then plug it into the equation for y, and what you get is a line with slope gamma dot 2 over gamma dot 1, and that gives you the slope of the curve as it's passing through this point. Sometimes you want to see what these curves look like in the local linear space of differentials, but here we have the curve in the manifold E2. We're using the x, y unit vectors, and in general you'll have components that are functions of x and y variables. So we'll call these components p and q. And to lie on the curve, you evaluate x and y coordinates using the time-dependent coordinate functions gamma 1 and gamma 2. Okay. So now we're going to take the partial derivative, equation 2. We're going to differentiate with respect to x and y. You have a function of x and y, and we just take the partial derivatives and write it in differential form like this. So notice here the differentials dx and dy are showing up. We will use the coordinate functions to evaluate dx and dy by taking the derivative of each of the differentiable coordinate functions. So here we're talking about evaluating each of these expressions on the curve. So you'll see these little bars and the values of x and y on the curve. We have this general form of the partial derivative in terms of the differentials dx and dy, and now we're going to change variables to just the parameter t. So that's going to give us an expression for the differential d gamma of t. So notice each of these factors, d gamma dx and d gamma dy, these are vectors, in general have an x and y component. So we factor out the x and y's to give you an explicit formula here in terms of the x and y components d gamma. So the x component is derivatives of p times d gamma dot 1 and 2 times dt, and the x's and y's are evaluated on the curve. So this shows the main features of how these parameter-dependent differentials appear. See, they have vector components. They are vectors. And so once you have completed the substitution, change of variables, expression for differentials on the curve that is only dependent on the variable t. In general, when you do these type of calculations, the basis vectors may be functions of the coordinates. And so when that happens, you end up with another group of terms where you have derivatives that are occurring, derivatives of the basis vectors. So you can rapidly escalate the number of terms here. But all of these calculations up to this point are just very straightforward application of partial differentiation, change of variables. Okay. So let's take a look at a physics example. We were talking about thermodynamic state space as an example of a manifold without a metric. Let's see what we can say about calculus on points in the state space. So in thermodynamics, you have variables like pressure, volume, temperature, the number of particles in the system. It obeys some equation of state, let's say here the ideal gas equation. Then a function that relates PV and T. PV and T coordinates. You have a surface here where PV equals nRT. Curves for constant temperature, you'd have these kind of hyperbolas here, isotherms for the system. This is all wrong, because the state space over here is a topological manifold. No metric, no orthogonality, and no orthogonal axes. So I tricked you into looking at these plots here. So, you know, if you want to be kind of rigorous about it, then you might say, well, it's not really correct to draw these Euclidean-looking spaces here, because we're really dealing with topological points. What do you have? So they don't have topological manifolds, do not have orthogonal axes, there's no dot product of vectors. So a better representation of the coordinates are just simply three real lines up here for P, V, and T coordinates. And you know, if you think about doing an experiment in thermodynamics, you're going to have pressure sensors, you know, the volume sensor and the temperature sensor all giving continuous readings as you move the knobs on your experiment. And so actually this is a kind of a more physical representation of a laboratory experiment. So a state 1 in the state space generates coordinates P1, V1, and T1. And so you can plot those up here on these axes. Here's the coordinates of the state 1. And besides that, you can, because we have continuous real numbers here, we can construct epsilon neighborhoods for DT and the other points. And so we have effectively a tangent space of differentials in neighborhoods of points of the system. Because we have these differentials, we can still do calculus on the thermodynamic manifolds. Now, let's come back off the high horse. I don't really like the idea of mathematical thought police. I think it's okay to think of anything you want. Intuition often involves pictures that are partially correct and partially incorrect. So, as far as I'm concerned, it's okay to think of PVT axes, but just remember, it's only a picture, so if it's helpful, use it, but it might be misleading in some cases, so you have to kind of watch your step when you're doing that. But as far as intuition goes, you can think about anything you want, and it's okay. All right, what does the local linear space look like? Well, here it is. It's just like a little neighborhood of those points in the vicinity of the state P. Let's see, we're not using P because it's thermodynamics. So let's just call this point here the system state 0. Well, now I've got the entropy. What are we going to call this system state? Let's call this the state of the system is a point in three-dimensional topological manifold. So we'll call this A0. So the point A in the state space of the system has values of pressure, temperature, and volume, and we'll make those the zero vector of the space of differentials around the point A0. So topological manifold, the local linear space looks like this. Of course, for Riemann manifolds, you have orthogonality, and so you can draw these three-dimensional axes, say for dx, dy, dz, for the tangent space at the point P. And here P is serving as the zero vector of the tangent space. So in this video, we're sort of just getting the lay of the land. We're not going to try to solve everything here in 15 minutes, but we're going to touch on some of the interesting things we have to do and maybe come up with a strategy for how we get to the rest of the points on the list we had at the beginning. So let's take a look here at we're in a position at least to kind of review some of the features of topological manifolds and come up with a partial definition. So this is a bit of a reminder. If you have a topological space, it consists of points, a set of points x, and a set of sets of points, tau, the topology of the space. A topological manifold adds to this topological space a coordinate generating function or set of functions that maps open sets in X to open sets in Rn, where n is the dimension of the manifold. Now, the fact that Rn is showing up here, Rn is really serving as sort of a parameter space. So even though, you know, if you have sequences of n numbers, you can add them up and do vector addition and do all these things directly on those sequences. But those addition and manipulations that you naturally can do with sequences of real numbers are not mapped back onto the topological space. They're not mapped to the topological manifold by the inverse coordinate function. So you have to be aware that just because you have a representation in terms of sequences of real numbers, you can't always do all the algebra that you would like to be able to do when you're dealing with a topological manifold. The manifold M has dimension, and it has this coordinate generating function, and in the usual way you can construct local n-dimensional vector spaces of differentials in epsilon neighborhoods of points in M. We do have differentials now in topological manifolds. No problem with that. Another thing to be aware of is that when you change coordinates, you know, a manifold has the topological space and the coordinate generating function. So, and it consists of the coordinate system as well as the topological space. But if you change coordinates, it's really the same manifold. And so MN can have alternate coordinate systems, and you're still dealing with the same manifold. So out of this discussion here, we have the tangent space at points P in the manifold M, local linear space of differentials in Rn. So that local linear space, we've called that DRn at xp, so at every point we have a local linear space of differentials. Okay, well, this is sort of just a quick walkthrough, a qualitative discussion with a few quantitative highlights on some of the features of topological manifolds. We'll be getting into developing how you do calculus, including functional derivatives, calculus of variations, evaluation of integrals on curves, and in two-dimensional regions and getting to Green's theorem on a topological manifold. This is a really fascinating topic, sort of a minimal problem. You know, we're used to having the luxury of dealing with Euclidean spaces, Riemann manifolds, where you can kind of calculate everything from advanced calculus. So here we have to look at things a little bit more basic way. We don't have all those handy tools, but I think we'll be able to soldier on and come up with calculus on topological manifolds as long as we observe some care. Hope you enjoyed this discussion. Please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.